So functional neurological disorder, FND, are neurological symptoms that are experienced by people, but they are related to altered functioning of brain networks rather than structural disease. So another way it's often described as problems with the software of the brain rather than the hardware of the brain. So in FND, people commonly experience movement problems or motor symptoms, things like weakness, tremor, dystonia, walking difficulties. They typically experience sensory problems such as altered sensation, numbness, tingling. They can experience seizures, and essentially any other neurological symptom can present as part of a functional neurological disorder. Yeah, so this is a really difficult question to answer simply. But actually, we know quite a lot about what causes FND, and there is no one cause. It's described as being multifactorial, so there's lots of different factors that cause or lead to someone developing FND, and there's lots of different ways into developing it. We often think about it in terms of risk factors, so things that make somebody vulnerable to getting FND, and this can be a whole range of things. One of the strongest risk factors for FND actually is having a neurological diagnosis, such as MS. But there are other things such as adversity in your lifetime. Neurodiversity is a risk factor for developing FND, and other things, even something like hypermobility. And then against the background of those risk factors, people usually experience a triggering event that sets it off. Often that's an injury or an illness. In MS, it could be a relapse that could then go on to set off a functional symptom. And then we think about them in terms of the maintaining factors, the things that keep those symptoms going. And they're the things that we try and target with our therapy. When you look at functional symptoms, such as a motor symptom, such as weakness, and you examine it, there's some really interesting things about it. And that is that the person's thinking part of their brain, their attention, is directed overly strongly on their body in a way that's not normal. So you don't normally think about walking or turning your muscle on so you can stand. But if you're in a situation where you are having to think about standing and turn on your muscles, those muscles don't work normally and you can't walk normally. And essentially that's what happens in FND. The person's attention is too much focused on their body and on their movement, and that interrupts the normal automatic movement patterns. And when you can redirect that attention away from their body, you push it aside, you can get some normalization of this. Somebody with a functional tremor, if you really get them to think about the other hand, that tremor can slow down or stop completely. So it's variable in that way, related to attention. And so this is a useful way that we can identify it. And it's also a useful way that we can start to think about ways to use therapies to treat it. So developing strategies that redirect attention away from the body and help people to move a bit more automatically. So functional overlay is a term we often use when somebody has another diagnosis, such as MS, and they also have functional symptoms or functional neurological disorder. So sometimes it might be better in some cases to talk about having two separate or two dual diagnoses. So they might have functional neurological disorder and multiple sclerosis. But personally, I think anybody can experience a functional symptom from time to time, and sometimes it's not necessary to have that extra diagnosis. So sometimes it's okay just to have a functional symptom and another diagnosis. So typically we describe someone as having functional overlay when they've got some very perhaps prominent symptoms that might not be related to structural changes in their brain or spinal cord. But they're real symptoms and they're experienced by that individual as involuntary. It's a good question, and sometimes it can be very difficult actually, because there are no biomarkers for FND, and you can't see FND on a scan. But functional neurological disorder and functional symptoms really are diagnosed by a neurologist. And they should be identified based on the clinical examination. So sometimes that's described as being a ruling diagnosis, or you identify them by the way the symptoms present. In the past, we used to think about functional symptoms as being a diagnosis of exclusion. So for example, if somebody has a neurological symptom and you do all of the investigations and you don't find anything, then it might have been thought of as FND. But nowadays they don't do that. And one reason is because you can do a different investigation every day and still not complete all of the investigations. If you try and diagnose FND by exclusion, you're more likely to misdiagnose it, because it can usually quite accurately be identified based on how the symptoms are presenting. So some specific examples is that functional symptoms can vary in terms of the severity of that symptom. Sometimes it might be very prominent and sometimes it might dampen a little bit. And there are clinical signs that a neurologist can do to identify them. A really common one is Hoover's sign. So a Hoover's sign is a clinical maneuver. If somebody has weakness in their leg and they can't push their leg down, so they don't have extension power in their leg when they're tested. But if they can move their other leg and they're told to lift up that other leg against resistance, you'll get automatic or reflex extension power return to the weak leg. So that tells us that the person can't voluntarily activate the muscles in that leg, but it is wired up by this reflex mechanism. So there is the wiring is intact, but the problem is in voluntary control of that movement. So there are hundreds of signs that a doctor can use to identify a functional symptom, and that's how it's best identified. I think it's important. We were talking earlier about health anxiety, and whether how that sort of exists with FND, and personally I think it's a separate thing, because health anxiety can exist in FND, but it doesn't have to, and health anxiety can exist in MS and doesn't have to. So I'm not an expert on health anxiety, but the way I think about it is that it's a lot of anxiety related to health or symptoms, and that anxiety causes its own sort of distress and, I guess, disability in everyday life. And that's something a little bit separate to FND. Usually treated with multidisciplinary rehabilitation. So it's very person dependent. For some people, if, for example, they have things like anxiety, health anxiety, or other psychological factors that might be driving those symptoms, a first point of call might be to see often a neuropsychiatrist or a psychologist, and to think about some psychological treatment. Physiotherapists and occupational therapists are important for movement retraining, and speech and language therapists can do some specific FND treatment. The best treatment is multidisciplinary rehabilitation, just like it is for MS, but we know that that's often very difficult to get access to. So you don't necessarily need all the treatments at the one time. It depends on your individual case. Not all therapists, physios, OTs, speech therapists are very familiar with FND, so sometimes you might need to look around to find somebody who has a bit of experience, because we find we get better results when your therapist understands a little bit about FND. So sometimes FND is described as a diagnosis that exists at the interface between where a neurologist practice and where a psychiatrist practice. So it involves both the mind and the brain, because those things are one, that it's an artificial distinction to separate them. It's probably a mistake to assume that everybody with FND has poor mental health. But rates of anxiety and rates of depression in people with FND are higher than they are in the general population. So it tends to be associated with anxiety and depression and other psychological and psychiatric symptoms as well. But it's not a one-to-one relationship, and it's not universal. So it is possible to have FND and not have poor mental health. If you think you might have functional symptoms, it is important to have that assessed by a doctor. General practitioners, so your GP, often might not know a lot about functional symptoms. So really the best person to speak to is a neurologist. And a neurologist will probably be able to quite accurately identify or talk to you at least about functional symptoms. Often it's not immediately clear if it's a functional symptom, if it's related to a lesion or a combination of the two. But I think the neurologist would be your best bet. If you've got functional neurological disorder, you can also get other neurological conditions, just like anybody else can. So it is important to get new symptoms assessed by a doctor. But equally, if you have MS, sometimes new symptoms aren't related to relapses. They might be, but they might also be something else. So it is important to think about new symptoms and make sure that you have the right diagnosis, that you understand what those symptoms are, and that you're on the right treatment course for them.